that's the rap on me, right? That I, you know, that I just kind of become a lot of different people, especially depending on the man that I'm with, that there's no there there.
Jane Fonda har många titlar. Filmstjärna, politisk aktivist, workout-drottning, filmproducent och nu också författare till sin självbiografi. Hon är dotter till Hollywood-legenden Henry Fonda och blev själv en erkänd och hyllad skådespelerska, vinnare av 2 Oscar. Men bakom den starka och framgångsrika kvinnan med den sexiga fasaden döljer sig en liten flicka med svår uppväxt, plågad i årtionden av kroppsförakt och ätstörningar.
You can be a strong, independent, smart, successful woman. But behind the closed doors of the intimate relationship, you can give up your voice.
And that's what you did.
Yeah. And I did it through 3 marriages and many affairs. And, you know, it starts early on in life, right, when you love your father and you can't make him love you unless you're perfect. So I have to be perfect. So, okay, there are all these things about me that's not perfect. So I'll leave them at the door and I'll only bring what's perfect in. Well, I mean, you can't really have a relationship when you're just bringing part of yourself to the table. Mm-hmm.
But when you were a little girl, right, it seems to me you were quite happy with yourself and quite doing whatever you like to do.
But that's what girls are. You know, we're feisty and we climb trees and we wrestle and we're tomboys and we're you know, we like me. I imagine myself a heroine leading armies and then I hit puberty.
And what happened?
And that's where it all begins to come apart. It's where you're confronted with what it means to be feminine, what it means to be a woman. And it was doubly challenging for me because my mother killed herself and I was not close to her. And for me, being a woman meant you were a victim.
So in your teens, there was kind of a critical eye starting to judge you from outside.
Well, there was always a critical eye from outside, my father's and my mother's. Mm-hmm. You know, I was too frivolous, I was too fat, I was too...
Is that what they said?
The eyes that your parents reflect you back with are very important, and my father saw me as fat.
Yeah? And your famous father, Henry Fonda, did he actually say you were fat?
Well, he never told me. He would tell his wives, he was married 5 times, he would tell his wives to tell me to wear bigger bathing suits, not bikinis, longer dresses, don't wear my belt so tight. You know,
and how did you perceive that?
That I wasn't good enough. Mm-hmm. And then clearly, if I was going to be loved, you have to be perfect.
Mm-hmm. There was also an incident with your mom when they were divorcing, and she wanted to show you a scar. She was newly operated.
She showed it to me, and I thought, oh my God, that's why my father wants to divorce her. You know, no one would want to live with someone that had that pink thing going around their body. And then she showed me her breasts, which also had scars. And I didn't know what that meant. I just felt really sorry for her. I found out in her medical records, she had written her own personal history at the request of the doctors, that she'd been sexually abused. I've been studying the effects of sexual abuse on girls for 10 years. I didn't know why I was drawn to this, but the moment I read that about my mother, I understood everything. Girls who've been sexually abused carry guilt. They hate their bodies, they tend to be promiscuous, they lose their sense of self, their parameters, and oftentimes their daughters inherit that sense of guilt and self-hatred.
So what did you think in this moment when your mother revealed her body to you?
I think maybe it was right then that I decided that I had to be perfect, that in order to keep a man, I could never have, you know, I had to be absolutely perfect.
So how did you find out about her suicide?
Well, I was told she had a heart attack, and a year later in school, someone gave me a movie magazine, and I read in the movie magazine that she killed herself.
Mm. So, so nobody told you?
No, just the movie magazine.
You devote a lot of your time and a lot of money to helping young kids in questions concerning...
sex.
Sex?
And gender.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
Why is that?
Well, because... Gosh, our women's bodies, our bodies, what's between our legs, how this functions, how it makes it feel, how other people have made us as females feel, this determines the rest of our lives. I mean...
But from the outside, it looked as if Jane Fonda, the daughter of a famous actor, beautiful, as it seemed to me, and, well, she had all the opportunities in the world, but you yourself was suffering, I mean, and you started having eating disorders as well?
Mm-hmm. When you, let's see, how to explain this. When you enter a girl, this is very, very common. When you're a girl, you enter puberty and you feel you're not good enough and you feel you have to kind of be something that you're not. Your chi, your core becomes empty. And it fills up with anxiety. And different people numb the anxiety in different ways. Drugs, alcohol, shopping. Oh, if only I had that pair of shoes, then it would be all right. Then I would be perfect. Well, my addiction was food. I became anorexic bulimic.
But you didn't know because there was no such words.
No, I thought I was the only person in the whole world to engage in such a disgusting thing. And I did it for 25 years and nobody knew, not my husbands, not my children.
How could you keep it secret?
It's much easier to hide than alcoholism. Very easy. Less easy now because people know it and you know what to look for. Less easy if you're married to or living with people who are paying attention. But people who are addicts don't marry people who pay attention. We're not conscious of choosing people who aren't really there and who don't pay attention. Usually we choose people who are also addicts. I'm guilty of that.
Den franske regissören Roger Vadim, som tidigare levt med Brigitte Bardot och Catherine Deneuve, lockar över Jane Fonda till Frankrike och de blir ett par. Jane blir kvar i Europa i 7 år och den präktiga amerikanska flickan förvandlas i Vadims regissörshänder till sexsymbol i rymdäventyret Barbarella.
Actually, his name was Roger Vadim Plemyanikov. I was Madame Plemyanikov.
And he was directing you in movies.
Mm-hmm. And that's very sexy.
That's
well,
what
first
I was going
to
ask.
His movies were sexy. And then to be directed by your lover in sexy situations, it's very sensual. You know, I was trying to get out from under the shadow of my father. I had played all these parts in movies where I was kind of the nice little cheerleader, American good little cheerleader, and there was much more going on inside me. And when I was offered a role in France, I went there and met Vadim, and I think I was trying to find out how to be a woman. And
did he teach you?
He taught me to be a female impersonator.
And he was also very non-bourgeois in his private life. He wanted you to have a very open sex life without jealousy and without limits.
Right, it was the 60s, right? And the greatest sin in the world is to be bourgeois. Mesquin, narrow, petty. Whether it was with money, whether it's with sex, jealousy, whatever. And God forbid I should be bourgeois.
So
I did, you know, to please him. The disease to please found its way into my first marriage. And he, you know, he liked to have two women. Well, him and me and another woman. You know, kind of a keeping up with the Joneses. I thought, okay, all right, I'll be the most wild, non-bourgeois person that he can possibly find. Mm-hmm. And I was.
And how did you like it?
Well, I don't know, because I would get so drunk that I would get angry, and then to kind of still my anger, I would drink a lot. But what I did enjoy was that in the next morning I would get to know the women. Mm-hmm. And it kind of, it created a sort of a humanity that lightened the objectification. And I learned a lot from those women. Most of them had been abused as children. Mm-hmm. They were smart. They were kind of like my character in Clute.
So thanks to them, you won your Oscar.
Well, it partly what I learned from them gave me insight into the character that I played in Clute, where I won my first Oscar.
Jane Fonda skiljer sig från Roger Vadim och flyttar hem till USA med sin dotter. Hon radikaliseras, börjar ett nytt liv. Hon startar en workout-rörelse för att finansiera olika politiska kampanjer. Jane gifter sig med aktivisten Tom Hayden. De får en son. Paret är starkt engagerade mot Vietnamkriget. Hanoi Jane blir ett begrepp.
When I first came back from France, I was, I was still looking like I did with Vadim, short skirts and transparent blouses and, and real kind of sexy. And I saw that women were very uncomfortable around me. And I was just beginning to understand the woman's movement. And so I decided I didn't want women to feel uncomfortable around me. So I just wore blue jeans and shirts, and I stopped wearing makeup. And of course, that made people mad. Including women. Why aren't you living up to our expectations of you? And, these articles started appearing like Plain Jane, doesn't she ever look in the mirror? I thought to myself, I've looked in the mirror enough, thank you very much. And so I was very plain, unadorned, trying to understand where I was, very lonely. There was nobody in my position. I had no roadmap. There was no very famous, award-winning movie star that was in the trenches of not just the anti-war movement, but with the Native Americans and with the Black Panthers.
But this part was beautiful, but there was also a part that was very painful for you because you were met with real hatred from a lot of people who were supporting the American war in Vietnam.
I made a terrible mistake in North Vietnam. My last day there, I was taken to a military site, and there was a little ceremony there. And after the ceremony, I was asked to sit down, and it was an anti-aircraft gun, and people took pictures of me, and I didn't even think what I was doing until afterwards. Well, that image is something that I will go to my grave regretting.
But the hate that you've been met with because of this mistake is very, very strong, and still on the internet you can buy stickers to urinate on Jane Fonda.
Yeah.
How do you deal with this hate?
I feel sorry. I feel sorry. A man, a veteran came to one of my book signings last April and he spit at me. As Dolly Parton said, fortunately it was tobacco juice, which is kind of sweet. And what am I supposed to, I feel so sorry for him.
Efter 17 års äktenskap blir Jane Fonda lämnad av Tom Hayden på hennes 51-årsdag. Ted Turner blir Janes tredje man. Den excentriske miljardären som förutom att han är USA:s största markägare mest är känd för att han startade medieimperiet CNN.
The day a divorce with Tom Hayden was announced, the phone rang and there was this booming southern voice. Is it true?
And who was this?
Ted Turner.
And did you accept the date?
I was having a nervous breakdown, though. I couldn't talk above a whisper. I said to him, I'm having a nervous breakdown. He said, I know just what you mean. He said, I just broke up with my mistress. He said, I left my wife of 23 years to go and live with my mistress, and she and I just broke up, and I'm having a nervous breakdown, too. And I thought, this guy is crazy. Doesn't he realize I'm going to identify with his wife, not his mistress? I said, call me back in 6 months, and he did. 6 months to the day.
And what happened then?
He courted me with a vengeance. Sort of like, you know, those wildlife documentaries where the male bird, you know, with plumes and the chest puffs mm-hmm. out and the feathers go like this. Mm-hmm. And he became one of those courting birds.
Mm-hmm. And you fell for it, totally.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's hard not to, sure. Mm-hmm.
And then what happened 1 month after you were married?
He had an affair.
1 month after you were married?
Yeah, yeah. And I found out, and I left.
And what did he say?
Oh, he just pleaded and begged, and for 2 weeks, I was gone. I was out of there. And then I found a therapist, and I said, okay, if you come with me to therapy, I'll give you a second chance. And he never was unfaithful to me again until the very end when he knew that the marriage wasn't going to work. Mm-hmm.
But what was his explanation to why it had been...
I said, how, we just got married. It's so clear. I mean, anybody that knew him knew he really loved me, you know, and we're having great sex. Why? And he said, I don't know, it's kind of like a tick. You know, like...
Only a man can say that.
He was just used to doing it. Once again, I had chosen someone who couldn't show up and couldn't pay attention. But it took me a while to realize that. Mm-hmm. You see, I had made a pledge with myself when I turned 60. This is my last act, and this is not a dress rehearsal. You know, this is it. We don't get to do it again. I'm going to die, and I'm 68 years old. I'm not afraid of dying. What I'm afraid of is getting to the end of my life with regrets when it's too late to do anything about it. And I knew in preparing for my 60th birthday that my regret would be that I had never experienced intimacy. And so when it was clear that it wasn't going to work with Ted, sad as it was, painful as it was, there was no choice for me. I could stay with him and die with regrets. Or I could be true to the promise that I made to myself. And I would live alone, that's right, single. Maybe forever, maybe not, I don't know. But I'm not alone, I'm with myself. Would I like to fall in love again with a man? You bet. Because it's not that I feel a lack. I don't. I don't feel lonely or anything. But I think that I'm really different than I was. But I can't really know until I'm in a relationship with a man again. You know, you can't find out when you're living with a dog.
But dogs are very nice to live with.
Yeah, but this dog, you know, this dog doesn't press all my buttons. Dogs don't, you know, cause you to silence your voice.
And you don't age.
Shall I show you my scars? Well,
like your mom did?
Actually, I thought of that when I just said that. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I have the scars that come when you have to have joints replaced and stuff removed and all that kind of thing. You know, I am aging. I mean, I look good for my age.
But isn't that something that a woman who lives an official life in this country has to do? You have to make small adjustments because you can't see an aging woman in the media at all?
It's very hard. It's very, very hard, you know, to resist it. And you know what helped me decide to not have any more plastic surgery? Going into the department stores. Go to Hollywood and go into Neiman Marcus.
What happens?
Everybody looks alike. Mm-hmm. Duck lips. Mm-hmm. You know, it's everybody looks alike. I would rather look old than have that look of Botox and plastic surgery. I'm not going to do it.
So you haven't done it?
Years ago I did it, mm-hmm. Yeah. But I'm not going to do it anymore, mm-hmm. No.
And what happened to your breasts?
Took them out.
You took them out?
Yeah. When Ted and I, Ted hated it. hated false breasts.
Why?
Because he's a man. So many men are raised to feel they're not manly enough. They're not competitive enough. They're not strong enough. They're not mean enough. They're not tough enough. They don't bully. You know, they're soft. They're, you know, this right-wing government that we have now, you know, when, you know, any politician like John Kerry who's in favor of the UN or international law, they say, well, he's a feat.
So they're victimized by a tough society.
On the most fundamental soul level, yes. And it's very true in this country, which is founded on rugged individualism, you know, the John Wayne ethic. You know, they've completely distorted the teachings of Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus Christ said, love thy neighbor as thyself. Think about that. That is totally revolutionary. And in this country, it has become God does for those who do for themselves. It's like, like that, you know. It's that toxic masculinity that's running this country right now. And I feel really, you know, really bad. So women who are strong and vibrant and whole have a hard time finding men who can meet them there. Yeah.
Where are you? When during your relation with Ted Turner, you turned to Christianity.
As I began to heal, as I was working on myself, this empty, dark place in me that had been filled with food addiction and that had then been filled with anxiety began to fill with reverence. With reverence. And the weird coincidence is that Ted brought me to the South. You know, in Hollywood, nobody goes to church, except my Jewish friends, to temple. And here, everyone does. And I became really interested. And I began to study it. And I became a Christian.
What would you say yourself was your contribution to mankind?
I think my contribution is my life. I do. I think my contribution is the way I've lived my life. It's an example to other people, especially women and girls. That except in the bedroom, I haven't compromised. And I've learned to have a sense of humor about myself.
You have an amazing film career. I mean, not only as a winner of 2 Oscars, but you also produced a lot of films like 9 to 5 and On Golden Pond and other films. And you've been a political activist. What are you most proud of all these things?
Two things. That I've grown up. Because it's not a given, you know. It takes work. And that my children are great. And that we're close.
But it wasn't always so.
Oh, man.
How was it when you got your first daughter?
Oh, it was hard. It's hard to be a good mother if you haven't healed from your own mothering wounds. I had to learn to mother myself.
So what kind of a mother were you to?
Not a good mother. And I fess up in the book. And I'm surprised how many people say to me, nobody ever admits they're a bad parent. Well, I mean, my daughter, if I had written a book and I hadn't fessed up about being a bad mother, my daughter never would have spoken to me again.
What does she say about this today?
New Year's Eve. We were together with a group of people. See, I've been working hard at this for a long time. We were together with a group of people, and I said, let's go around the table and say what's been the most important thing that happened to us this year. And she was sitting right across the table from me. And she looked right at me, and she said, you. And I knew exactly what she meant. And it was the most important thing that happened for me, too. There's been a change. And I'm 68 and she's 37. It's never too late. And I think in some way she would never admit this, but I wanted her to understand who I am and why I am this way. Not to blame anybody else, but to, so that she can understand it had nothing to do with her. So that was one of the reasons that I wrote the book for my daughter. So she could see that, yeah, I was not a good mother, but it had nothing to do with her not being lovable. So it's been a good year.
Did your father ever get around to that kind of insight?
No. It's a generational thing. Do you know, he came from the Midwest, Nebraska, and he was of an age when people, especially men, they didn't look into themselves. It just wasn't part of their lexicon to ask why. Hated therapy, hated the actor studio, hated anything, faith, religion. He hated anything that would require introspection. It scared him too much.
And you made this film on Golden Pond for him?
Yeah. He was dying, and I wanted to be able to work with him before he died. I also kind of thought maybe that he would win an Oscar. And he did.
But you didn't get close to him anyway.
Do you know, if you have a parent, if you have a father who's been this sort of huge, iconic figure over your life, and then he gets old and he gets sick and he shrinks, literally and figuratively, and suddenly you're stronger than he is, there's a strange thing that happens. You don't know if he's really, if the armor around his heart has melted, but it feels like it because he's vulnerable. And so I felt that we got closer. I don't know how he felt.